don't need that. I'm Puerto Rican, and you know how Puerto Ricans are. Very loud people. We speak loud, by the way. My name is Gus Ramirez, and I started my career in corrections in 1978 as a correction officer. I worked in Fishkill, and basically I've worked in a majority of those prisons there, including Clinton, up there in the boondocks where that escape occurred. I worked there for a short period of time. I worked at Green Haven. Green Haven is in Stormville, off 84, and 2,200 inmates worked there. Lived there, excuse me. Out of the 2,200, 2,000 are doing life. And 90% black and Hispanic. So I've been working in the field of corrections and criminal justice since the 70s. I also worked in the Texas prison system as a director of their treatment, in-prison therapeutic community treatment in Amarillo, Texas. I did a couple of years there. And I basically went back to the prison system in New York and retired in 2013. In between there, I worked in many substance abuse programs, and Veritas in New York City I worked for as a clinical director, and I finished it off in corrections running the substance abuse program in Hudson, New York, Hudson Prison. But I'm going to give you a different twist. This is the human part of it, and the human people in the prison system. I'm going to paint a different picture here, and I'll start off with a broad stroke. I have done this before, but it takes a couple of hours, so I'm going to shrink it down to about 3 or 4 minutes. So basically, I want to start talking about capitalism. Capitalism. Capitalism is the most wonderful thing, as well as the worst thing ever created by mankind. Capitalism is the cause of global warming. Capitalism is the cause of why our oceans are depleted of fish. Capitalism is the cause of all, I have gone scuba diving in the Pacific Ocean, and I've been all over Pacific Ocean scuba diving. And I gotta tell you, everywhere I go diving, no matter how deep I go, I'm gonna find plastic floating in the bottom. You see sometimes fish have pieces of them stuck in the gills. Plastic is enormous. It's a huge problem. I don't know how they're going to resolve that problem. But anyway, capitalism. Capitalism is what drives America. It's what makes us who we are. Capitalism is what makes these cars safe and safe to drive. Capitalism is what creates those planes that we could go from here to anywhere in part of the world. But another part, addiction. Addicted to tobacco, addicted to drugs, addicted to sex, addicted to gambling, addiction. The one addiction that you don't hear about, nor is it put together with capitalism, is the addiction of money. Believe it or not, I think most people, and I've seen studies, I read books about people who hit lotto, about 80% of people who hit big in lotto and lottery lose all their money and end up in poverty as a result of the way they handle money. In many ways, capitalism creates addiction to money. You think about all the billionaires in this country, in the United States. The one thing they do, they won't retire. They don't quit. Even though they have enough money to live for the next 500 years, what they do is they sit in front of their laptop every day and they look to see how much money they're making today. The Walton family, Walmart stores, they watch that computer, they watch their bottom dollar every single day. That's all they do. Why? Because they're addicted. Yep. They're addicted to money. So on that realm, I want to talk about the prison system. In 1981, there was about 350,000 people locked up in the U.S. And basically, 1981, the most famous president was elected, Ronald Reagan. But in 1981, something happened in New York that opened up Pandora's box. In 1981, the Department of Corrections went out on strike in New York, including me. We walked out. In 1981, Governor Cuomo had to call President Reagan and get assistance with the Army to cover all the prisons where the COs walked out. And that was 90% of the correction officers walked out of the prisons because of a 2 or 3% increase in salary. What that did in regards to Pandora's box, it brought attention to the cost of prison and inmates. They put it together and they figured it out. And in 1984, I think it was the first time prisons were privatized. Mm-hmm. Community Corrections America started to create and run prisons. And basically, Community Corrections America and many others, smaller ones, are control 25% of the prison budget in the United States. We're talking about last year alone, the Community Corrections made gross $7.4 billion and they netted $1.64 billion profit in their pocket. So capitalism is what's driving the prison population. Capitalism is what, where you really, if you want to really make a lot of money in capitalism, get into the business of war, making weapons. I mean, there is a ton of money in that. So the best way to make money is to declare war on something. So declare war. They declare war on drugs. Basically, that opened Pandora's box. And 60% of the people in prison today, including from the 80s and to today, 60% are non-violent offenders. Most of them are users. Majority of them are users. Many of them were caught with half ounce or an ounce of marijuana and are doing time because of that. And here in New York, the Rockefeller laws really had an impact on that. Mm-hmm. It put a lot of people away. But we went from, I think in New York it was about $9,000 a year per inmate. Today, in New York State, it costs $60,000 per inmate. It's not manageable, it's too expensive, and that's not really the true figure. This is what they put on paper. They say $60,000. But I know, working in these prisons, that doesn't include administrative costs. That comes out of the budget of New York State. That doesn't include health insurance. That comes out of this state budget. That doesn't include pensions, contributions to pensions. If you include all those numbers, we're over $100,000 per inmate. One of the reasons why you're starting to see them cut back and reducing prison time and releasing a lot of inmates, non-violent offenders, mostly addicts, back to the community. It is the reason why Obama right now is pushing to release a lot of people from the federal prison system. I don't know if you've seen that special on HBO. Obama went to a federal prison in Oklahoma, and he spoke to inmates, and basically they realized they don't want to feed that addiction anymore. Using people, using inmates to feed an addiction of money to some rich character. So basically, what we have here is an addiction and inmates, and basically that's what's feeding it. So in New York State, one inmate costs $60,000 and doesn't include the cost. In Rikers Island, New York City, any of you from New York City, right now the current cost keeping one inmate in Rikers Island is $168,000. And here's more shocking news. What you don't hear about is the cost of incarcerating adolescents, Division for Youth, or OASAS here in New York, $211,000 to incarcerate one youth in a facility. And there's, I think, three or four in New York right now that still houses maximum secure facility for these youth. Over $200,000. I retired from the Department of Corrections in 2013. I am working now in Massachusetts for an adolescent program, maximum secure facility, 15 boys, 15. I think three or four of them are Hispanics, the other are blacks, I think there's one white kid in the bunch. And the state of Massachusetts pays $212,000 per child there. And I gotta tell you, it's a complete waste of money.
Absolutely.
Nothing is going to change. These young men, 14, 15 year olds, are only going to be promoted to state prison. And that's the horror about this. This is feeding into that capitalistic, money-driven addiction in the United States. And it's not going to change anytime soon. We just heard she talk about the $40 million for the county jail here in Columbia, right? Right. Let me see some others. Doesn't include probation and parole. Those numbers don't include that. A parole officer currently makes between $60,000 and $90,000 a year. The difference between probation and parole is basically probation is you don't go to prison, but you go on probation. You commit a crime, the judge convicts you, he puts you on probation. Parole is you do time, and then you finish your sentence in the community, and you're on parole. You have a parole officer. So that cost doesn't include that. The recidivism rate, which is driving this, is keeping the prisons full, is over 50% in New York and in the whole United States. 3 years, out of every 10 inmates that leave the prison system, 5 come back into prison within 3 years at a cost of $60,000. So it doesn't work. It's a waste of money, and it has such a negative impact on families. In all the prisons I worked at, and even today, I have been fortunate that I have never been hurt by an inmate. An inmate's never put their hands on me, and fortunately, I learned how to treat them in a humane manner. And then what you're hearing here, these young ladies talk about how these inmates will protect them and won't put their hands on them because they are treated in a humane manner. I always see that the employee, the correction officer or the correction employee who treats them like animals is the one that scares me the most because he's going to get hurt.
Yep.
And that's been my experience. I thank you. I appreciate being here. Mm-hmm. Any questions about that? Thank you.
Do you have any...